is a world. This is a world premiere. This is a world premiere.
I done been through a whole lot. Trial, tribulation, but I know God. Satan wanna put me in a bow tie.
Pray that the holy water don't go dry, yeah, yeah. As I look around me, so many motherfuckers wanna down me. But enemy gon' never drown me. In front of a dirty double mirror, they found me. And I love
welcome
myself.
Happy Friday to all you clowns out there. This has been a rather quiet week in the world of sports, with the exception of, obviously, the biggest news. John Jones checked himself into rehab for a little too much partying that he has been doing. But the biggest news of it has been the fact that Dana White has proved just how hypocritical he really is by not punishing John Jones, B, not stripping him of the UFC light heavyweight title, even though it was pretty much given, proven, that he was a little bit under the influence before the fight, and C, and this is the one that's most important, that John Jones will remain champion even while in rehab. Living proof, solidifying the fact that Dana White is the world's biggest chicken shit. I'm going to call it like I see it because, quite frankly, Dana White deserves everything that he's about to get. The backlash from UFC is coming. I don't give a rat's ass whatever every single person sitting there has to say. I don't give a damn if every fighter sitting there saying, well, he's the champion and, you know, he deserves a reprieve and blah, 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 blah. Who gives a shit? If the Diaz brothers pretty much are getting punished for this, then so should John Jones. If Brock Lesnar, Frank Mir, Shane Carwin, GS fucking P, all had to relinquish their titles due to injury or some weird crazy act of whatever, then John Jones should not be held to a higher standard. You called the guy a role model, but yet you're saying it's okay for your role model to basically sit here and use the Rick James excuse for what happened. It doesn't matter if he apologized. It doesn't matter if he actually said, I'm sorry, I'm going to rehab. It does not matter. John Jones, you fucked up and you deserve some consequences. And since your illustrious boss does not have the balls to actually do it, then you just get suspended and fined and stripped by the public. The people who looked up to you. The kids who said they wanted to be just like John Jones. Unfortunately, this is not the case here. Because those kids are basically going to be brainwashed. Because that's what parents do these days. They brainwash their kids into believing what they want to believe. And that's exactly what's going to happen because it's already going on. We're now led to believe that professional wrestling is actually good to watch in regards to World Wrestling Entertainment. And this past Monday was living proof of how much it absolutely sucked. The flipping airways went crazy. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, the works. All was going crazy following the ending to Monday Night's Raw, in which saw Dolph Ziggler, Ryback, and Eric Rowan all fired with the return of the Authority. Now, John Cena lives by this motto of never give up. Didn't John Cena just give up a week ago and bring back the Authority? I know, I got all respect in the world for Edge. Do not get me wrong. But the fact that basically WWE was okay with the very fact of risking Edge's livelihood, his life, so that they can pretty much do a storyline is kind of bullshit. But the biggest thing that's bullshit of all is the fact that they didn't capitalize on an open opportunity that they had, which was giving the WWE Universe something to actually believe in. A light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak. A silver lining in the dark cloud known as the Authority. No, it's back to basics. It's back to the way it was before Survivor Series. And now here we are sitting here, right back where we started, and people are still trying to figure out what's going to happen next. I'll tell you what's going to happen next. You saw the post between Twitter and Facebook and Instagram. And as much as Mick Foley wants to say it wasn't that bad, it was worse. So yeah, I guess in that case, Mick Foley was right. It wasn't bad, it was worse than expected. The ratings took a huge plummet because of the fact that the Authority returned and went back to their old shenanigans. You gotta give people something new if you want them to keep watching. Which is why Ring of Honor is going to capitalize on this. Which is why NXT most likely is going to capitalize on this. And that's a WWE company, FYI. Which is why the real reason that WWE is moving SmackDown from Friday to Thursday. There is a reason for it, and it's because of TNA. Because of Impact Wrestling. As much as anybody wants to say otherwise, fuck you. Don't say shit about it. Why? Because if you look at it, look at what's about to happen here. Before they made the announcement that Thursday was going to basically move, TNA was basically trying to scramble around, trying to find a new TV deal. Spike didn't want to play ball because they're all, they're all hard up on Bellator, and they figure Bellator's going to save them. Not reruns of Cops, not Bar Rescue, not even Ink Master can save Spike for what's coming. They got nothing anymore. They gave up WWE. They gave up TNA. Unless they pretty much sign a deal that brings Ring of Honor to primetime television, they got nothing working for them. Which brings us to this little fiasco going on right now. Impact Wrestling now has a new home, Destination America. They actually had their premiere show literally this past Wednesday night just to give the fans a little taste of what's coming. And that's exactly what we got. Because of that, they actually opened up on their new network to some actual pretty decent ratings. Granted, they were going up against Empire that night, and I'm pretty sure if you're not a wrestling fan, Empire was what you were watching. But if you were a wrestling fan, you were going to be kind of curious on how Impact was going to open 2015, and that's exactly what we got. Impact was exactly what we expected it to be, and I was so proud of the very fact of what had happened. Which brings me to the reason of why WWE is moving SmackDown from Friday to Thursday. Because TNA's flagship program, Impact Wrestling, is slated to be premiering next Friday night. Let me make sure you heard that right. TNA's Impact Wrestling will premiere next Friday night. Yes, you heard it correctly. Why in the hell would WWE want to sit here and give its competition a fighting chance when it's got the perfect opportunity to kill any major company that can give it a run for its money? Now, granted, they don't have that talent power, star power, but where's the star power anyway? We spent the entire duration of Monday night sitting here hearing the same bullshit storylines from 2014. So maybe he's not really showing us anything that we haven't already seen already. Short of actually bringing back not only all three of those men, but also bringing back The Rock and Stone Cold Steve Austin and Randy Orton and The Icon, not the Vigilante, not the Rebel, The Icon, the legend, the man called Sting. Short of bringing those guys and putting them on the same road to WrestleMania as they're about to put everybody else on, WWE is probably going to end up losing a lot more than they expected. And what happened to this whole storyline about Edge and Christian suing WWE for everything that happened? Shouldn't they have played a part in everything that was going on that night? Or are they just going to sit here and just blow smoke up everybody's asses yet again? I'm assuming they are because we haven't heard anything yet. But I digress. Obviously, John Jones and WWE has pissed me off so much this week that it's just making me pull my hair out. And the fact that people are actually supporting both entities right now is embarrassing to me. Not just as a sports writer, not just as a sports reporter, but also as a sports fan. It's embarrassing that people are actually okay with a cokehead keeping all the spoils that he pretty much received, the endorsements, the deals, the championships, the money, not getting punished in any way, shape, or form by some bald-headed flapjack who doesn't know his asshole from an elbow, who was apparently suffering from rectal cranium invasion, and on top of that, apparently he suffers from Dallas Cowboy Planet Homeitis, where he can't see anything, where he can't see anything. I don't fucking get it. But that's okay. Because apparently it's not my call to sit here and be pissed off. We're supposed to just take it, according to the world, according to both WWE and to UFC. Well, how about these apples? I had a lot of John Jones apparel that I was basically sitting here and had in my closet. You want to know what I did? My friend has a dog, and I took all my John Jones apparel, everything that had John Jones' face on it, and I put it out in the snow that's outside. And then I pretty much fed my friend's dog laxatives. My friend's dog literally sat here and took a shit on all of John Jones' stuff, and it was the greatest feeling in the world. Then the snow came and covered it up, which made it even better, because that fresh powder is what got John Jones into the hot water that he's in. Which, if I make any more cocaine puns, I'm pretty sure that Rick James is going to come out of the grave and just slap the shit out of me. So I'm going to move on from it. But Dana White, just know your time is coming. And I'm sorry to disappoint you, Sorry about your damn luck, but you will pay for your sins just as much as John Jones will. You both can go fuck yourselves. And if you don't like it, Dana, I'm in Colorado. You're coming to Colorado in a couple of weeks or even a couple of months, as a matter of fact. In about a couple of hours from now, I'm actually going to be heading up to Denver to Dwayne Bane Ludwig's gym opening. So, Dana, if you happen to be there and you got a problem with me sitting here calling you a pussy, then come on down and I'll show you. You know what needed to be done and you failed. So, fuck you. Why? Because fuck you. That's why. Which brings us to the ending. We got 5 great games coming up this weekend. Starting up in about a couple of hours, of course, we have obviously Baltimore and New England. Last week, I actually thought I did a lot better on it than, we did a lot better last week than I ever expected to, which is a good way to start it. So, let's put it into a perspective that we know about. Baltimore and New England, I'm not going to go against the grain. And when I say I don't want to go against the grain, it's basically because of the fact that, if you look at the stats, as good as Tom Brady is, he's always had one team that's always been the Achilles heel, and that team has been, two teams in all honesty, Denver and Baltimore. But they can beat Denver at home, but they can't beat Baltimore at home. Baltimore, with Joe Flacco at quarterback, is 2-1 heading into this week. This week, this weekend, this afternoon. I'm going to say it's going to be 3-1. I'm going to take Baltimore over New England. I think that, as good as Darrelle Revis is, he whines too fucking much, and I don't like whiners who sit here and complain about, oh, I deserve this. I'm the greatest quarterback of all time. I'm blah, blah, blah. You remember what happened to the last guy who ever said he was one of the best of all time? Richard Sherman punched him in the fucking mouth and told him to shut up and don't bring his sorry ass around him again. Which brings us to the second game. Nice segue, guys. Good job with the writing. Seattle and Carolina will collide tonight in the 12th man. No longer being called Quest Field or New West Fest Field or Seahawks Stadium. It's basically the house that the LOB built. And in that house, not many people come out alive. Especially if you happen to be a sorry receiver like Crabtree. But Crabtree is not in on this one. This will be Carolina. This will be Cam Newton versus Russell Wilson. Two of the best quarterbacks in the NFL right now. Two of the best young black quarterbacks in the NFL. Easy, guys. Don't go crazy on me now. And they will both be in the house. I cannot see any, as good as these games have been, don't get me wrong. Every single time these guys play, it always comes down to the wire. It's always a battle, always a fight. So with that being said, I say Seattle wins this, but I say Seattle barely wins this one. I know they're a great playoff team, don't get me wrong, but the fact that Carolina, with the team they got now, and Seattle, with the team they got now, have been literally making this a nail-biter through and through, I say this will probably be the closest game you have all weekend long. It's probably going to be Seattle and Carolina, but I'll take Seattle to move on to their second straight NFC Championship game. Which brings us to the AFC. Oh, I'm sorry. No. Sunday. I'm like losing my mind right now. This coffee, if you haven't had iced coffee before, my suggestion is you get it quick. That's glorious. Now, brings us up to Sunday. Now, and anybody, as well as everybody knows, we have ourselves a nice little conundrum going on, and everything's been working out well. Everything's working out perfectly. Sunday is going to be no question about it. You got the Packers taking on the Cowboys in the frozen tundra of Lambeau Field. Anybody who saw TLC's page saw the pictures that we posted in reference to Lambeau Field. We're lucky enough to actually not be in Lambeau because, quite frankly, I'm a skinny SOB, and I'm pretty sure that probably would freeze what's left of my nuts off. You know, the portion of my nuts that my ex-wife didn't take in the divorce. But that's besides the point. When it comes down to it, I see Green Bay winning this game for one simple reason. They said something has to give. Dallas is undefeated on the road. Packers are undefeated at home. Can Tony Romo get it done when it counts? Of course. Of course Tony Romo can get it done when it counts. But does he have enough left in his tank to beat a wobbly Aaron Rodgers who is still suffering that calf injury, not just from the tightness of the calf, but also from Ndamukong Suh basically sitting here sticking some cleats in it? Just saying. This was karma for you, Ndamukong. Which brings me to the biggest thing. Hey, all you people that are still bitching about Dallas and Detroit, wake the fuck up. It's over. It's done. Detroit lost. You can whine, you can bitch, you can moan and complain all you want to. It does not matter. They lost the game. They didn't play to win, obviously. Stafford had a chance, two to be exact, to win that game at the end, and he choked on both tries. So, shut up. It's over. Just focus on hockey and basketball, if you can. Baseball's coming up. Maybe you should focus on that, too. Anyway, my pick is the Packers to beat Dallas, but not by much. I think that in the cold, I haven't really seen it work. Romo, obviously a native of Wisconsin, he may have a better shot at it, but Dez Bryant has not played in this kind of weather in a long time. So I'd say that may be a good be-all and all of it. But I will take Green Bay at home to keep that undefeated streak alive, setting up Seattle versus Green Bay next week, which should be interesting. I would love to see Dallas versus Seattle because since the Cowboys are undefeated on the road, to go into Seattle and beat the 12th man probably would be epic. But I'm not going to, you know what, I think I am going to split them out. I think I'm going to call an upset. I'm going to call an upset for one simple reason. Because I always have at least two upsets, and I've been picking home teams literally nonstop. I mean, I picked home teams all last week, and look how well that worked for me. Thank you, Big Ben, you sorry sack of shit. So let's go with this one. New England, they're going to lose. So I'll take Baltimore, I'll take Seattle, I'll take Denver, just to sit here and rub it in the craw of fresh. And you know what? Just for the sake of argument, in the cold and the frozen tundra, the last Ice Bowl was a nail-biter. This one will be no different. I'll still stick with the Packers, mainly because of the fact I know how the Packers roll, and on top of that, I also know how great the Packers play in the cold. Despite Aaron Rodgers being hurt, I'm still going to take Green Bay to win this damn thing. Which brings us to the grand finale of our sports football weekend. The college football playoff national championship on Monday night. And literally, my brother, big Ohio State fan, one of my closest friends and colleagues at work, big Ohio State fan. Both of them trying to literally drill it into my skull that Ohio State's going to win. And with one of Oregon's primetime targets pretty much on suspension because of a little weed. Are you starting to notice a trend here there, Dana? This guy was smoking weed and he got suspended for a national championship. You can't even pull the trigger on your precious love child, John Jones. It's like the sports world just keeps coming full circle back to that. So, that being said, let's look at it from this angle. I am never going to pick against the Ducks in a win-or-die situation. Jameis Winston said he had no problems beating the Ducks. Look how well that worked. So does the Buckeyes. They feel confident because they beat a mediocre Alabama team with Lane Kiffin as offensive coordinator. This is the big difference between Oregon and Alabama. Oregon puts up at least 40 points a fucking game, whereas Ohio State was lucky to put up 40 points in the last game. If they have stiff competition, expect fireworks. Wisconsin only had a running game. Alabama barely had a passing game. Michigan State was probably the toughest game that Ohio State had in the final stretch of their season until Monday night. I'm taking the Oregon Ducks. Final score, Oregon 47, Ohio State 34. Suck on that, Buckeyes. God loves the Buckeyes, but not on Monday nights. They have never played well on a Monday night game, and if you don't believe me, just ask Troy Smith how Tim Tebow bitchified him. A backup then. Chris Leak, who's not even in the NFL. Nobody's seen him since he got drafted. Again, gone. In fact, why don't the Buckeyes ask Urban Meyer how is it possible that he was able to outsmart Jim Tressel, who was putting up more points than the Gators at the time? You got to think about the bigger picture, people. But the bigger picture's coming to you. This has been the captain. This has been TLC. I'm going to try to do as much editing on this rant as possible and try to have myself some fun today. I'm going to get ready for Denver. You guys have yourselves a great time, a great weekend. We'll see you guys next Friday night for an all-new edition of TLC. Love you, boys. Love you, Nessie. I miss all my kids. All right.